Good morning, everybody. You all found it okay. It's not much, but it's home. I brought Archbishop Rowan here this morning, and he sort of face dropped as I said. It reminds me of Lambeth Palace. In a moment, I'm going to hand over to Professor Sarah. But just before that, two parish announcements. The first is our second bookstore, arrived in 2002, and it's been set up now for the St. Paul's. So if you want to visit that, drink a coffee. The other thing, I was asked about short papers and how wonderful. I think we'll all agree they've been wonderful short papers. This is a suggestion. I was hoping to talk to everybody. Oh, right, sorry. I'll get this turned.
You need to.
I'll get the IT.
You need to speak right into it, Peter. Right into it.
Into it. Yeah, like that. Yeah. Sorry. I'm just the warm up band. Short papers, my suggestion, I've taken this decision unilaterally. If any of the short paper contributors want to send me an electronic version of their short paper, we'll put them up on the conference website, so at least they're in the table. I've just made a decision without your... I was suggesting with the short papers, if contributors wanted to send us an electronic version, we can put them up on the web conference website. So that's one way to make that decision. Anyway, I'm going to hand over now to Professor Sarah.
I'm going to come around here and genuflect in front of Teresa. It's a very great pleasure and a great honour to come here from Cambridge and introduce one of my colleagues. Rowan Williams is already well known to, I think, almost all of you now. Lord Williams, a oyster mouth master of modern Cambridge.
Try this. And I realised very early this morning that I've known him about 45 years since we were students together. And amongst his many accomplishments, is an extraordinary little book on Teresa of Avila, published at the beginning of the 90s, which I think remains by far the best book on Teresa in the English language. More recently, he has given the prestigious Gifford lectures at Edinburgh, published as The Edge of Words, which has provided his theory on how God seeps through the fractures in the language of poetry. Rowan, without further ado, I'm going to hand you this piece of machinery which you'll have to use with...
Well, good morning, everyone, and I hope... Is this audible?
Yes.
Thank you very much. I feel uncomfortably like a variety act holding back and forth on my mouth like this, but this is probably the safest way of approaching things. It's an enormous pleasure and privilege to be invited to take part in this event, and as always, a delight to be able to speak about St. Teresa. I was comparing notes a moment ago with Professor Vernon McGinn, and we agreed that we had a little cluster of Teresa papers that were doing the rounds this year in all sorts of contexts. But of course, when this happens, it's an opportunity to enlarge, define, and correct in the light of discussion. So I'm looking forward to what you have to tell me. I'm going to speak about Teresa as a theologian of the Eucharist this morning, because I believe that one of the somewhat neglected areas of her theological thinking is the enormous and central importance which the Eucharist has for her whole conception of religious reform and the religious life. And what I'll be arguing is that the Eucharist has this significance for her because of the particular way in which she understands the Eucharistic act and, just as importantly, the Eucharistic presence. Those of you who know her work, The Way of Perfection, will recognise that in the introduction, she casts her religious reforming enterprise very clearly in terms of a response to the crisis of the Reformation. Because, to use her famous image, she and her contemporaries are living in a world in flames, the construction of reformed, simplified, evangelical religious communities is a way of making reparation, redressing a balance in a seriously diseased Christendom. And for her, the Reformation is, as much as anything else, a crisis in Eucharistic devotion. She looks northwards and sees in France what she calls Lutherans destroying churches. I don't think the Calvinists of France have been at all flattered either by being described as Lutherans or by being accused of destroying churches, but that's another story. What she sees is a rejection of the Eucharist, a rejection of the Eucharistic focus of the church by means of a rejection of the church as a home of the sacrament. The language she uses is very emotive. The sacrament is being cast out of churches, quite literally. The tabernacles and ombres of the Middle Ages are being removed by reformers. So Christ is being cast out of the church. What's being taken away, as she puts it, is the notion of the church as a place of invitation, a place of invitation. The church as physically representing, through the reserved sacrament, the welcome that God extends to God's people. So, in this context, where Christ is being made homeless, what do we do by way of reaction? As we'll see later on, part of the answer is that we make Christ another kind of home in the intensity of the religious community. I'll come back to that theme later. But it's important also for later comments that we register that image of the church as a place of invitation. And the notion of the Eucharistic presence, he doesn't write so much at this point about the Eucharistic action, but the Eucharistic presence as a sign of that welcome, that invitation. But as she reflects on this, she brings in also one of her frequent, almost obsessive themes, and that's to do with honour. As many people have argued, the notion of honour is focal in so much of what she writes. Her own ambiguous social and ethnic background, as someone coming from a convert Jewish family, means that she is hypersensitive to issues around status and honour, and is determined in all her writing to underline the fact that conventions of honour are overturned in the religious community. The only honour that matters is the honour given by Christ, and the only kinship, the only family status that matters is being adopted into the community that calls God Abba the Father. And that, of course, is a theme you'll find pervasively in her work. But in this particular context, as she begins her reflection in the way of perfection, she imagines the religious life itself as a statement about the honour of Christ. Christ is not only being made homeless in the religious conflicts in France and elsewhere, Christ is being dishonored. Christ, in his vulnerability of the sacrament, has exposed himself to dishonor, to public repudiation, as if he is once again exposing himself to his passion and death. And what the religious now has to do is to witness to and plead for the honour of Christ. Teresa, with rather characteristic irreverence, says that since apparently God the Father isn't doing anything about the honour of his Son, it's for us to step in if we can. One of those moments where the inquisitors looking at the manuscript wrote despairing comments at the margin. So, the religious life becomes a testimony to Christ's honour, but also a plea a way of praying to the Father that Christ be honoured, and in that prayer, so to speak, answering its own petition. By that prayer to God the Father to honour Christ, to stop this desecration that is disfiguring Christendom, the religious witnesses to and defends the honour of God the Son. In all this, the community itself for Teresa becomes what you might call a Eucharistic demonstration. A Eucharistic demonstration. The invitation to friendship with Christ and the proclamation of God's faithfulness in Christ are made visible in the actual form and shape of community life. At a time when Christ is being made homeless, the community makes him a home. And more particularly, of course, the praying person makes a home for Christ. And again, I'll come back to that. So much by way of introduction. But I think it's very important to recognise that the whole of the way of perfection is framed by that particular vision of reformed religious life as a specific response to a crisis in Eucharistic piety. A crisis, therefore, in Teresa's mind, in ecclesiology. But most of what she has to say about the Eucharist in this work is contained in chapters 33 to 35 of The Way of Perfection, when she reflects on the petition, "Give us today our daily bread." Now you'll notice, looking at these chapters, that the discussion is again framed by specific reference to what's going on in France. The Lutheran, inverted commas, assaults on the Eucharist are quoted at the beginning and the end of the treatment of this petition. The sisters, in contrast to what's going on elsewhere in Europe, are to be exemplary receivers of the sacrament, and as such, literally, housings and embodiments of Christ's presence, with all that that implies. But the petition, "Give us today our daily bread," is for Teresa already quite a complex one. She dismisses the idea that we could possibly be asking for ordinary physical sustenance here. That is unimportant, she says. Let that look after itself. Again, the inquisitors were rather worried by that and put a note in the margin. But she says, to ask God that we be given our daily bread in the spiritual sense is to ask God to go on exposing himself in Christ to suffering and rejection. The Christ who is prayed for in this petition, whose presence is invoked in this petition, is the Christ who, she says, is crushed to pieces every day. Crushed to pieces every day. The literal consumption, the crushing to pieces of the sacramental bread, becomes a sign of the crushing of Christ by the sin and the anguish of the world. And when Christ tells us to pray that this be given day after day, is for Christ to tell us to pray that he will not be taken from us. To pray to the Father that he, Christ, will not be taken away from us. Christ tells us to pray that he will go on being given, being sent into the world. And somewhere in that is a very complex and rather profound insight that, in effect, when we pray that prayer to Teresa, we pray for Christ to go on showing himself to be the carrier of the eternal missio, the eternal divine mission, which is his. We pray for Christ to show himself the second person of the Trinity, in fact, eternally issuing from the Father's love, and eternally destined to run his course through suffering, death, and resurrection in the world. To put it slightly differently, the Eucharist here becomes a manifestation of the eternal divine mission, a manifestation of a Trinitarian relationship. is Teresa's exegesis in the same section of the day that we're praying about. Give us this day our daily bread. It's a day which, she says, is as long as the world lasts. The day is the day of the entire history of the universe. When we pray to be given our daily bread each day, we pray that Christ will continuously be what he is in the world as long as it lasts. And that day, as long as the world, is the day which Christ passes in the form of a servant, in the form of his humility and his vulnerability. So the Eucharist is, on the one hand, a manifestation of the eternal divine mission, on the other hand, a manifestation of the form of the servant. A manifestation of the divine commitment to be in the world as vulnerable, as at risk, till the very end of time. The Eucharist is a manifestation of eternal fidelity and also divine solidarity with human nature and human weakness. And it's tempting to characterize it as a deeply Chalcedonian reading of the Eucharist. So much so that I shan't even resist the temptation. It is a Chalcedonian reading of the doctrine of the Eucharist. That is, a way of seeing, reading, apprehending the Eucharist as a manifestation of the inseparability of divine and human in the presence of Christ. In the course of this, Teresa has a brief but interesting passage in which she seems almost to anticipate the Kierkegaard of the philosophical fragments. Now, as all of you will remember, in the philosophical fragments, Kierkegaard has a long discussion about whether there is any advantage to the first generation believer. Is it easier or better to have the faith of someone who sees Christ, experiences Jesus, in the flesh? And Kierkegaard, of course, has very complicated reasons for thinking that we shouldn't go there. But in a rather Kierkegaardian way, Teresa says, we should not be consumed by a sort of nostalgia for the historical Jesus. I paraphrase her words, but that, I think, is the point she's making. We're not to imagine that it would have been much better, inverted commas, to be there in the first century. First generation, as such, has no privilege, because what is significant is what is now happening in Christ taking up his presence in the soul. And just read briefly some of what she says there. Just a moment. Discussion in which she insists that trying to visualize Christ as a particular human and historical other in this context is a mistake. You have to pray to him by looking at his picture. It would seem to be foolish. You would be reading the person himself in order to look at a picture of him. Wouldn't it be silly if a person we love very much and of whom we have a portrait came to see us and is not speaking with him so as to carry on a conversation with the portrait? I want to know when it is good to have a picture of Christ, and when it's a thing which I find much delight. When he himself is absent, or when by means of a great dryness he wants to make us feel he is absent. It is then a wonderful comfort to see an image of one whom we have so much reason to love. Wherever I turn my eyes, I would want to see his image. With what better or more pleasing thing can our eyes be occupied than one who loves so much, and who has in himself all goods? But after having received the Lord, since you have the person himself present, strive to close the eyes of the body and open those of the soul. Look into your own heart. And she says also, the Lord had given her, that's a sort of tactful third person, she often uses such living faith, that when she heard some persons say they would have liked to have lived at the time Christ, our good, walked in the world, she used to laugh to herself. She wondered what more they wanted, since in the most blessed sacrament they had him just as truly present as he was then. That's chapter 34, section 6. For the Kierkegaardian moment. The sacrament is the contemporary entry of Christ into the soul, and it's no use saying it would have been nice to see Jesus, because Jesus is here. But likewise, it is entirely appropriate to say it would be nice to see Jesus now, because instead of seeing an image, we have the presence, the inner conversation with him. And in this process also, she recurs to the same imagery of housing the Christ who has been made homeless by rejection. So there's one cluster of themes emerging in Teresa's account of the Holy Eucharist. This is simultaneously an affirmation of the eternal mission of the Son, sent by the Father for us, and sent, secondly, in the form of the servant from beginning to end of time. Therefore, as really active and present here and now, as I receive the Eucharist, as in Palestine in the first Christian century. Moving on, we've already seen hinted the significance of what she has to say about image and reality in relation to the Eucharist. It's not, in fact, fitting, she says, that we seek to see Christ as he is in his glorified humanity. 34:9. To see him in his glorified state is different from seeing him as he was when he walked through this world. On account of our natural weakness, there is no person capable of enduring such a glorious sight, nor would anyone in the world want to continue in it. In seeing this eternal truth, one would see that all the things we pay attention to here below are lies and jokes. Beholding such great majesty, how would a little sinner like myself, who has so much offended him, remain so close to him? We can't, in fact, bear the sight of the glorified Christ as he is. And so, Christ, actively and really present, adapts himself to our capacity and makes himself, in another of Teresa's bold and provocative phrases, easy to deal with. We, I think, know Teresa well enough not to take it too literally. Easy to deal with in the sacramental form. We're not intimidated, totally unsettled, and uprooted by the vision of the glorified Christ, as that glorified Christ actually is. That means also that the receiving of the sacrament is bound up for Teresa with a certain rather unexpected ambivalence about the physical image of Christ, as in the passage I quoted a few minutes ago. After we've received Holy Communion, we should not look outside, but inside. We should not be trying to stir up devotion with visual and intellectual aids. We should simply be sinking into our interiority, our own heart, where Christ is. Since you have the person himself present, strive to close the eyes of the body and open those of the soul and look into your own heart. As in the interior castle and other works, she makes clear here, when it's appropriate and useful to make some use of images of Christ. As she says elsewhere, if it helps to have a picture of Jesus in your pocket, well and good. But this is a moment when you are nothing but, so to speak, the tabernacle of the living Christ, when you are nothing but the dwelling of Christ, when you've received Holy Communion. That's not the moment for looking anywhere else. There is here, to borrow what may be a slightly provocative turn of phrase, there is a real non-duality about this moment, when Christ is definitively here, within the heart. We're told by those who knew Teresa that she wrote intensively in periods after receiving Holy Communion. that she wrote at a pace which seemed superhuman to those who observed. Those who had seen her scribbling at her praetor in the half hour after Holy Communion were astonished at the rapidity and fluency with which she wrote. But she herself, many times in the spiritual testimonies, records insights coming to her after Holy Communion, so intense, so complex, and so rich that she had to struggle to get them down on paper. Something of the same, I think, is reflected here. What is happening after you've received Holy Communion is a profoundly privileged moment, a moment when you may expect to be in tune with the life you've received in a unique way. And if you're Teresa and a compulsive writer, that's the time to get your pen out. But also, that abiding, that sinking into the heart, looking into the heart after Holy Communion, becomes for her, as she reflects further on it, something unexpectedly to do with identifying with Christ's vulnerable fidelity. Because, of course, it's rather hard work looking at Christ in your own heart. And it may be rather easier looking at an icon or a crucifix. So, the temptation to look for a more rewarding, emotionally or imaginatively satisfying relation with Christ in this moment is a real temptation that has to be resisted quite strongly. And that's when our simple abiding with the gift of Christ in the self after communion becomes an image of Christ's own faithfulness. Christ stays with us faithfully for all our rejection, for all our indifference. And so we, in that period after we've received Holy Communion, we are to stay with him faithfully. We are to put up with whatever frustration or lack of emotional intensity, lack of imaginative colouring, to put up with that, because that's part of the suffering whereby we mirror his costly faithfulness to us. And we'll see that laid out in chapter 35. We have to suffer something that he may understand, we desire to see him. Since he suffers, will suffer everything in order to find even one soul to receive him and lovingly keep him within. Let your desire be to do this. Christ suffers everything in order to find a home. Once again, the theme of Christ tabernacling, finding a home in us. And when we faithfully put up with whatever lack of obvious consolation we're experiencing after Holy Communion, we're doing our small part in providing a home for him and thus allowing him to be faithful in us, reflecting that faithfulness in our own practice. So if we're tempted to any more obviously emotionally satisfying devotion, this is the time to resist that lure. But in all this, and here Teresa returns to the theme that she flags up at the beginning of the work, in all this we are, she says once again, witnessing to and pleading for the honour of a Christ who has no will to defend himself. And when she touches very briefly on this theme again in her meditations on the Song of Songs, she says, this is a moment, this is a relation as a communicant, when we speak for Christ, because he speaks for us. He speaks only for our honour. He speaks for our security, our well-being, our anchorage in the grace of the Father. So the best we can do is to stand up for his honour by receiving the Eucharist in this way, by abiding in that imageless moment when he is in the heart after Holy Communion. So these relatively brief chapters in the way of affection, I would argue, contain a really rather sophisticated Eucharistic theology, and a theology which casts light on a number of broader themes in Teresa's work. What I see emerging here is a doctrine of the Eucharist with four main points of interest and priority. The first one, as I've said, is the notion of the Eucharist as in some sense manifesting and embodying the divinity and the humanity of Christ, manifesting the eternal mission and the form of the servant, manifesting the eternal relation of Son to Father as sent, manifesting the form of that sending in solidarity with human suffering, vulnerability to human rejection. And so secondly, the Eucharist is very strongly a sign of the abiding significance of the fall of the servant. It's connected, therefore, to Teresa's familiar and elsewhere much elaborated suspicion of all those who think that there's a point in the spiritual life where you can sort of do without the incarnate Jesus, where you have to stop thinking about the incarnate Jesus. She has some very strong things to say about this in the interior castle. And as many have noted, it's one of those areas where she stands significantly apart from some of those strands in the spiritual tradition which she's inherited. And I think I mentioned in the little book I wrote on her some years ago that it's one of the main areas in which she disagrees flatly with Osuna and is in some tension with at least some aspects of St. John of the Cross, but that's a long story. When she touches again briefly on some of this in the interior castle, she notes in 6. 6:14 of the interior castle, that those who repudiate devotion to or meditation on the incarnate Christ are putting at risk devotion to the Eucharist. As we've seen, it's not that she wants us to be thinking about the incarnate Jesus all the time, quite the contrary. She wants to see the incarnate specificity of Jesus of Nazareth as the central condition for the continuing presence of the form of the servant, the vulnerable Christ, here in the Eucharist, in relation to each particular person. So, when she says in the castle that one reason for not sidelining the awareness of recognition of the significance of the Incarnation is that your Eucharistic devotion will be weakened, she is, I think, saying something the same, which is arguing in the way of perfection, which is the form of the servant is the abiding reality, and the Eucharist is, above all, the crystallization of that form. Third, she's making some strong points about the presence of Christ in the soul, and in Interior Castle 5:1, she has what at first sight appears to be slightly in tension, a statement at first sight slightly in tension with what she said in the way of perfection, but actually I think bears out some of what we've been arguing. In 5:1 of the castle, she contrasts the sense of unity that is coming to birth in the fifth mansion, the sense of the presence, the pervasive presence of divinity within the soul, contrasts this with the sense of unity with Christ that's generated by a physical encounter with his humanity in the sacrament. But I don't think that she is in any sense intending a contrast or a disagreement here between the two kinds of encounter. I think what she is saying is rather that there is a particular level, a particular aspect of encounter with the form of the servant in the Eucharist, which is a necessary but not a sufficient condition for that other kind of union experienced in the advanced stages of the castle, where the sense of the pervasiveness of Christ's divinity in the soul becomes clearer and clearer. That encounter with the humanity of the Eucharist is part of the journey towards the sense of divinity, not as it were locked up in any object, but pervasive now in the interior of the heart. So the sacramental union doesn't do everything, but nothing can be done without it. And finally, the fourth point, there is what she has to say about the Eucharist and our reception of the Eucharist as linked in with our acceptance of suffering, the lack of tangible devotional satisfaction or focus, which becomes part of the way in which reparation occurs through our reception of the Eucharist and our life in community. We house Christ. We house the homeless Christ in ourselves. And so, speak for, act for his honour in a world where he is dishonoured and will go on being dishonoured, which is why we have to go on being communicants and being people of contemplative devotion and fidelity. Those four points, I believe, add up to a very interesting, a very orthodox, but also a rather original Eucharistic perspective. And what I've been suggesting in these remarks is that understanding something of why the Eucharist functions for her in this way is part of understanding the whole rationale of reform, religious reform. But there is one final point worth touching on in her Eucharistic thinking, and that's in one of her spiritual testimonies from probably 1575. The testimonies, of course, as I've said, regularly record insights, perceptions that come to her in post-communion period. And in this 52nd testimonies, she writes as follows. Once after receiving communion, I was given an understanding of how the Father receives within our soul the most holy body of Christ, and how I know and have seen that these divine persons are present, and how pleasing to the Father this offering of his Son is, because he delights and rejoices with him here, let us say, on earth. For his humanity is not present with us in the soul, but his divinity is. Thus the humanity is so welcome and pleasing to the Father, and bestows on us so many favours. An unusual, even a startling image. The Father receives in our soul the sacrificed humanity, Christ. The Father's divinity is present in the soul always, waiting for Christ to arrive. Divinity is there already. The strange thing about ourselves, really, is that the absence of divinity is not an issue. We ought to know that in us, in our very being, God is. What is absent is the restored, redeemed, and healed humanity. Christ's sacrificed and glorified humanity advances to the Father through the medium of communion with us. A great deal, I think, that could be said about that, but it is, again, a deeply unusual and striking insight. The historical sacrifice of Christ, the effect of that in the life of sacramental grace, is seen as the process by which there is a coming of the Son to the Father, a union of humanity and divinity. And that, I think, casts some light on the way she touches on this theme in the interior castle. Once again, the sacrament is not everything, but indispensable. Because without that coming together of the abiding divine presence itself and the advance into that divine presence of restored humanity, then of course there would not be the healing of self, community, and world. The Eucharist here is what allows Christ's accomplishing of his eternal mission and relation to be realized in time, in our time, here and now. And that perhaps is one of the most important features of this Eucharistic vision. What is happening is that the love of the Trinity occurs in us in the Eucharist. Or we occur, we come to be in it. How could one tell those apart? But it's not only in the time of my individual life. It's for Teresa in this particular time, when, as she sees it, the actual possibilities in the world around of realizing that Trinitarian reconciliation are under threat of being eroded by what she understands as the repudiation of sacramental life and sacramental presence in the Reform. Teresa knew virtually nothing about what was happening in France, except that it was very terrible. And the very fact that she can call Calvinists Lutherans indicates how little she knows. But the theological point she makes is nonetheless worth pondering. Something is happening in the mind and heart of Europe in her day, which has to do with the pulling apart of something that belongs together, which has to do with a shrinking of the radicality of the vision of how the Holy Trinity comes to be in us. A Calvin or a Luther and their major followers would have argued, quite plausibly and credibly, that what they were protesting against was a schism in the soul already existing in the late Middle Ages, and that they were trying to put it back together as well. Yet, what we have, I think, is from Teresa a powerful and positive vision, which by seeing the Eucharist as so deeply rooted in the realities of Trinitarian and Christological doctrine, allows us to see above and beyond the conflicts of the day what a Eucharistic life and a Eucharistic church might be, how the I call the non-duality of the Chalcedonian formula and of our own advance in contemplative grace, how that might be the key to the restoration of a common life in which we could reasonably say Christ is present and active.
Some more water, I'm going to open the floor now for some questions. We've got about 20 minutes. While people are thinking, I'll just bring a tiny extra coda question of what you just said at the end, because I think I may not be the only one in the room who would like to hear a little bit more about how Teresa's rather unique perspective on Eucharistic presence and sacrifice. Actually would compare with Luther if we ever managed to get them in the same room. Am I not answering that one?
Thank you. The thought of a conversation between Brother Martin and Sister Teresa is quite a hair-raising prospect. You know, the W.H. Auden... Well, thank you. The W.H. Auden invented a game called Purgatory Partners. Try to imagine people who at least like to spend eternity in each other's company. I think the example he gave was Tolstoy and Oscar Wilde. But that's However, that what might have said, there's actually a rather interesting article by Jürgen Malte on Luther and Teresa, worth a glance on this. But I think, well, let's take Luther for a start. Obviously, Luther's own Eucharistic theology is dominated by two features. One is the passionate, uncompromising assertion of presence, actual presence, in a sense at least as robust as the medievals. The other thing is an equally powerful insistence on the utter priority of the single divine act in the Eucharist, which is the original one. There's no supplementing, there's no qualification. I'm not sure that Teresa would have disagreed with that, because actually what she's talking about is, if I'm right about this form of the servant shaping that open thought, what she's arguing is that the incarnational and the redemptive act is indeed one act, and it's the act that is happening now. So they would have found something to talk about. I suspect that if we turn to the Reformed world, the Calvinist world, whether on the continent or in England, we find something slightly different. The emphasis there is so strongly on what Christ is doing in heaven for us.
So you have to go there.
You've got to go there, yep. Yes. And I think that's one of the interesting differences between the two perspectives. Spatial perceptions, somehow, yes. And then, of course, if you go a little bit further on the spectrum, where you get to the notion that the sacrament is, with the best will in the world, an extremely potent visual aid. I don't think Teresa would have much time for that one. So she could have something in common with Luther. She could have a very interesting argument with Calvin. I think she'd probably slam the door and say,
have we still got the other one? Because, oh, you're going to go around. That's great. So let's see some hands. Yes, here. Can you say who you are? So Rowan knows. He doesn't bring them.
My name's Kathy Bishop. I'm a little nervous, but she's going. Throughout this whole conference, and particularly hearing about what St. Teresa was saying about the Eucharist, was to try and teach her sisters.
Kathy, we can't hear a list.
Sorry. Teresa's writings were to reform and to teach her sisters a new way. And I just wondered what I find in the church now, I'm Catholic. We have to go and search for any help with the interior life. What would she say today to the ordinary person in the pew about how to expand their interior life to become the Christian that Christ wants us to be?
Gosh, that's about as comprehensive a question as could be. Thank you, Kathy. Right. I think she would want to direct her remarks in two directions. She doesn't, of course, address the general Christian public, but it seems to me that there's very little she says that doesn't apply pretty much to that. Because what she's saying is the foundation of the Church is the call to friendship with Christ. Friendship with Christ entails a rigorous purification of all the attachments and illusions that we habitually make ourselves happy with. And yet, frankly, whether you're saying your presence as sisters, whether you're a Carmelite sister, or whether you're a plumber, or even a professor, the problem's the same. Get used to it. So I'm pretty sure she would have said that, and I'm pretty sure she would have been glad to see those who attempted to make the contemplative path that she outlines more accessible. After all, she herself is a singular example of somebody who was, by the standards of her day, regarded as not really worthy to have that sort of position, that all the problems she had with ecclesiastical authorities who thought that women were not really suited to the contemplative life at all. It is, isn't it, one of the great ironies of history that there's a sort of modern myth that women are naturally more contemplative than men, which is exactly the opposite of what they believed in the 16th century. The second thing she'd have to say is that she would round on the clergy and say, what do you think you're doing? No. In your hands is the bread of life. And if you're an educated cleric, well, then you ought to be making a difference to the life of the body of Christ as a whole. And I think she'd be pretty outspoken about that.
Yes.
as a Tony Swinger, Catholic priest in the Liverpool diocese in a parish, and I feel as a Catholic that is very helpful for me, wanting to, as you say, make contemplative path more accessible to ordinary Christians, to all Christians, as Bernard McGill was talking about yesterday. When you say the sacrament is a necessary, indispensable, but not sufficient cause of the Trinity happening in us, and we have, I find as a Catholic that's so helpful to be able to defend Eucharistic spirituality for which we've got such a history. But at the same time, say, the faith, the receptivity of prayerful contemplative life is intrinsic to our sacramental understanding, but we've had it so much as an objective mechanical. Given that in 2 years' time, 2017, so many are looking to 500 years of the other purgatorial partner, Luther, starting the Reformation, how can we use 2017 in England to further the mission of Teresa and Christ to be one Eucharistic Christian community? I know that's not a very comprehensive question, Dr. Williams, but 2017 is another 500th anniversary. This surely is where we need to go.
Thank you. Has anybody got any easy questions? thank you. I think one of the things that's going on in the Reformation is precisely a reaction against a mechanical view of the sacrament. And when theologians of that age, not least in the Church of England, talk about the necessity for faithful reception, and indeed faithful reception as a condition of the presence of Christ in the event, they are reacting, perhaps overreacting, to that mechanical side. I suspect that when a Church of England reformed theologian like Richard Hooker talks about reception and faith as a condition for the presence of Christ, he means above all, if you want Christ to act in you in the sacrament, then you have to be actively expectant, open. So, you know, it's getting that clear. Now, I would love to see, of course, in a couple of years' time, some advance made in our mutual Eucharistic hospitality, but I know that's a long and difficult road to walk. But I actually take some comfort from the fact that there are now quite a number of ecumenical statements about the Eucharist, Anglican, Roman Catholic, Lutheran Catholic, and so on. I'd love to see those dusted off, distilled into something which would say, look, this is what the great mainstream vision of the Eucharist in Christendom is. We believe this is where the living Christ is active in and for us here and now. And you know, whatever else we argue about, we really do believe that jointly. We disagree about the mode of presence, we disagree about who gets ordained, we disagree about quite a few things. But, as I think I argued in an event at the Vatican a few years ago, it really is crucial that we don't lose sight of the fact that there is a Eucharistic vision that can focus our enthusiasm. And it is, to me, about that sense of the eternal and temporal act of Christ, the mission of God in Christ, the form of the servant in Christ. That is happening. And a few years ago, somebody asked me what sort of Eucharistic belief you needed to have in order to get ordained in the Church of England. Now, that could be either the shortest or the longest conversation. but my answer was, well, the question I replied with was, do you believe that Jesus Christ is presently active in this event? You can say yes to that. That's the key.
Yes, please, introduce yourself.
Hello, my name is Chris Webb. You talked about the way in which the Eucharist revealed or made present, or I don't want to put words in your mouth, the mission of God, and particularly the mission of the second person of the Trinity amongst us, which is something that a lot of us are very interested in, but in a very different context from Teresa's, where she was in a Christendom context where it was primarily about Christ being made known to people who were already in some sense Christians. We're very conscious now of the mission of God, Christ being made known to people who are largely alienated from him or have no relationship with him. Is there anything in the way that Teresa speaks about the Eucharist that could be useful to us, although I'm aware that the context is very different?
Thanks, Chris. Yes, that's a very, very good question. Two or three things come to mind, I think. One is that that image of the place of invitation remains a very powerful. We need to be saying the thing that most characterizes the church is that sacramental moment where we're all redefined as guests, all of us, whoever we are, whatever we're from, to be part of the body of Christ is let God redefine it as a guest, in that sense. And I think that is one of the foundations on which Teresa builds her quite sophisticated account of what it is to be a friend of Christ, and how friendship with Christ creates a sort of egalitarian vision in the church, how it challenges various kinds of exclusions, hierarchies, and so forth. She's a loyal member of a hierarchical church, but she also knows that what the hierarchical structure does not do is tell you the fundamental truth of our kinship in Christ. So I think those two things at least can and should be part of what we take from her to share with the wider public today. It leads straight into that complicated question of how a sacrament which is, I would say, inevitably bound to the community that are baptized can become a sign of hope to those who are not baptized. I don't think the answer is simply to throw open access to the sacrament to everybody. Some people think that, I'm not convinced. But I do think we have to show that what the sacrament is about is that equality and universality of access to a particular sort of relationship. And I think there are many different ways of doing that, but that's where I begin, you know, at least.
Hello, I'm Roddy Campbell Gunn. I hope this is not a question of going from the sublime to the ridiculous, but in response to your question, easy question, could I just actually ask the last point you were making? Sorry about this. You were talking about the Father as the abiding presence within the soul, receiving Christ coming into the Eucharist. Did you actually say where that came from in Teresa? I'd like to follow that up.
Yes, it's.
Sorry about that. Stupid question.
Okay, it's the Spiritual Testimonies, number 52. Number 52.
Joel Robson, I hope this is an easy question. How often did Teresa and her sisters receive communion? Because there is a bit in the Book of Foundations where she talks about a sister who thinks that she won't survive physically unless she has communion every day, and Teresa's quite cross with her about that. Feeling that, so I raise the question because it suggests that daily communion was not the norm, but I don't know whether I'm wrong about that. That may just be a false reading on my part.
Thank you. It's an intriguing question to which I don't know the exact answer. Daily communion for the laity, of course, would be unthinkable at the time. The sisters are still lay people. My hunch is that a confessor and a superior in a convent would set some kind of regular rhythm, but I don't know the precise answer.
Do any Carmelites in the room know about this? Yeah.
The constitutions apply virtually some of his, the great feast or even daily according to the discretion of the confessor. So it would depend on the individual.
That's what I would guess, yes.
One more question, I think we've been waiting. Do say who you are.
Hi, I'm Ryan Baracco. You intriguingly mentioned non-duality as a way of thinking through some of what Teresa's up to. I wonder if you could say more about what you mean by that and her wider thought. Well, that term can be used in different ways, thinking about consciousness, thinking about whether it's a kind of reality of the world that's being revealed. I mean, that would be one way, perhaps, to think about the interior castle. I don't know. So I wondered if you wanted to say more about that.
Well, yes.
not an easy question.
Yes. How long have we got? But briefly, I suppose what I'm trying to draw attention to, and I'm deliberately rather trailing my coat by using the phrase, I like the term non-duality because it allows us to take on board what comes through so clearly in the work of somebody like Nicholas of Cusa, when he uses the non-alliot. God is non-alliot, not another thing. So when we talk about non-duality, we're talking about that particular kind of union and communion between realities, which is not like the relationship of one thing to another thing, one fixed substance to another fixed substance. And of course, one of the big mistakes we make about Christology sometimes is to suppose that something called divinity and there's something called humanity, and somehow or other, by some amazing bit of magic, God's managed to stitch them together in Jesus Christ. Wow. That doesn't help me at all, because it makes divinity just another one of those things. And the one thing we all know, don't we, is that whatever divinity is, it's not just one of those things. So wherever we're talking about the union of finite and infinite, we're talking about at some level non-duality, but a communion which is not just the relationship object to object. Equally, we say non-duality rather than indiscernibility or absorption, because we're not simply talking about something being absorbed into another thing either. And if it's difficult to find words for this, well, not surprising really. Not only Christianity, but other great religious traditions have notoriously found it very difficult to find words for things. But it is one of those areas where, speaking personally, I found that the ongoing dialogue with my Buddhist friends keeps prodding me and pushing me on this. Because one of the things which emerges so lucidly from the best of the Buddhist tradition is just remember that when you're talking about the unconditioned, you're not talking about a thing by definition. Therefore, dot, dot, dot.
Rowan, this has been a wonderful session. We do thank you for your time, and we send our blessings on you as we rush back to your college to chair yet another meeting. Thank you.